question, Rajesh. Yeah, so Rajesh had asked me to speak sometime last year, but because of some personal reason, I could not, so I'm very happy to come. I see that there's a small crowd, so you please feel free to interrupt me at any time to ask questions. In particular, I'm not talking about something in mainstream graph theory, so although I will mention some connections. So if anything is not clear, please do. So I'll start by introducing a dynamical system which recently gained some attention on labeled chips. It's a discrete dynamical system, and there's a very interesting conjecture there, which I'll say. Then I'll explain how this thinking about this dynamical system led us to a dynamical system on permutations. And I'll state the main results. And I'll explain some of the key ideas in the proofs. And if there is time, I'll extend this to what I'll call collapsed permutations. Don't get scared by the huge number of slides. I have no intention of going through everything. We'll see how far we can go. So this paper is based, presentation is based on two works. One is with Daniel Hathcock and Prasad Ketali last year, and an extension of this with Pierre Cabeny earlier this year. So here's a new sorting algorithm, which was introduced in 2017 by Hopkins, McConville, and Thorp. I'll call them HMP. So what you do is the following. So you put n chips labeled 1 through n at the origin on the integer lattice. Now at each time step you do the following probabilistic scheme. So you look for all the positions which have two or more chips, and among them you pick one of the positions uniformly at random, and pick two chips from uniformly at random from that side, side I, let's say. And if those two chips are alpha and beta, with alpha less than beta, you move alpha to site I minus 1 and move beta to site I. So, in other words, at every time point, you pick two chips and you move the at the same site, and you move the smaller to the left and the larger to the right. And you lather, rinse, and repeat until you reach a point where the new position has two or more chips. Let's illustrate this with an example for four chips. So initially you have four chips at the origin. So there's only one site, and so that's the site, and you pick two of them at random. So let's say I pick two and four. And so I move two to the left and four to the right. Now again, there's only one site where there are two or more chips, which is again the origin. And here there are exactly two chips. I don't have a choice. So I pick 1 and 3, 1 moves left, 3 moves to the right. And now I have two sites which have two or more chips. So let's say I pick this one, then 1 moves left, 2 moves right. And then I again have exactly one site, exactly two chips, so again no choice. And at the last stage, I again have no choice, and I end up with this configuration where 1 and 2 are there. There's nothing at site 0 and 3 and 4 are there. Is there any question about the dynamics? I mean, I want the dynamics to be clear, because otherwise the rest of the talk will be completely incomprehensible. Are there any questions about the dynamics? So it is probabilistic, right? So there were some choices to be made. Here for n equals 4, there was not much of a choice, but you can imagine as n gets larger and larger, you will have more and more freedom. So at the end, you might get something completely random. So here, in this case, you seem we seem by accident to have gotten this the sorted configuration. But maybe that was not always sure. But this is the theorem of HMP, is that when n is even, the chips will end up at positions which is minus n by 2 to minus 1 and 1 to n by 2. So 0 will not be, there will be nothing at site 0. and they will always be soil. This is their main idea. So even though there's a lot of randomness in the process, you will always get the sorted. So this is what I mean by a sorting algorithm. That's why I call this a sorting algorithm. But I should say, for those of you who are computationally minded, this is not a very efficient algorithm. So, but it's an interesting algorithm. But this sorts only for an even. So let's look at what happens in an example where n is odd. So again, I've described the process and go rather fast. Now, so initially there are 5 chips at the origin. I pick 2 and 5 first. Then I pick 1 and 4 again at the origin. 1 goes left, 4 goes right. Then I pick these 2. Then I pick those 2. And now this is the penultimate stage. So now I choose to pick 2 and 3. And now you see I get the chips 1, 2, 4, 3, 5. So they are not in sorted order. But you notice that at this point, if I had picked 2 and 4 instead, 2 would have gone left, 4 would have gone right, 3 would have been exactly where it was. And so you would have gotten the sorted possibilities. One of them gives you a sorted sorting, the other two don't. And the surprising thing, again, okay, so this is an open problem there. So when n is odd, first of all, it's easy to see that the chips will be end up in this positions minus n minus 1 by 2 through n minus 1 by 2, including the origin. But their conjecture is that when n is odd, the chips get sorted with probability tending to 1/3 as n goes. Okay, so somehow this thing, the intuition is that odd. One-third. Conjecture is that it gets sorted 1/3 of it. So this is still an open conjecture, and there have been many things people have tried. So these people have tried, mainly Carly Clevens and his students have tried to prove this 1/3 conjecture, and have derived nice combinatorics related structures, for example, some post sets associated with it. And is if you know a little bit about Coxeter groups, you know that this is like a type A graph, and people have generalized this to other group systems. But I'm not going to talk about. But I want to motivate how we approach the problem. So I'm going to modify the process. Yes, please.
So I quite don't understand why 1/3 is the correct number even to conjecture. I mean, there could be a lot more mess if we have a lot many more chips. Right?
Yes. So it's a numerical conjecture. I mean, this I was just giving you some intuition. But they did, these guys did a lot of numerics. For very large systems, and they seem to find it.
I should, okay.
It's not hard to program it, actually, because you run, it's a probabilistic algorithm. You just, even for n equals 100, you can run it a million times without taking too long, and then you can see the numbers. So that's what they did, and they sort of stared at it closely, and their intuition is what I kind of explain. Yeah, but that's a good question. Yeah. Okay, so now I want to modify the process. So suppose I take n even. Okay. Remember, for n even, we always get sorted. And I fix some r, some particular chip r. So in this example, I fix this chip r equals 3. So when n is 4, r is 3. And I assume that this chip labeled r is infinitely heavy. Okay, so you cannot move it. Okay, so it's stuck there. You can choose any two other chips, you cannot choose that. Okay, so if you now assume that you can't touch R, but you can do whatever the hell else you want, then when you when you run through the process, you will reach a stage where you have two chips at the origin and one chip in these other positions surrounding the origin. So again, in this n equals 4 example, this is kind of a silly example because there's only one thing to do. So in the first state, suppose I pick 2 and 4 instead, 2 and 4, and then I end up at this situation. Remember, I cannot touch 3. So at this point, you're stuck. There's nothing more to do, right? So now if I, you know, light an arc and then I let the process continue, you know, by the HMP theorem that I just mentioned, you're guaranteed a sorted problem. But if I look to the stage before where R was still infinitely heavy, which was this configuration in that example, then you can think of this configuration as a permutation pi in S n minus 1 plus an extra label R. So in this example, you can think of this permutation pi as 2, 1, 3 and R equals 3. So somehow, I can't have 3 twice, right? So when I put this 3, I shift the labels all greater than 3 by 1. So I get this arrangement. And what the HMP theorem guarantees is that any such configuration that arises this way is guaranteed to be sorted. Right? So any permutation which I get from starting with n chips at the origin and doing this process until this step, if I think of it as a permutation, as a pair of permutation pi and a chip R, then such pairs are guaranteed to be sorted. And what we asked ourselves is, what are all the pairs? Are these the only pairs? Can we try and classify such pairs? And so that is what this work is about. Okay, so let me set some notation. So so now my n is going to shift a little. I'm going to consider my permutation pi in Sn. So n even for HMP corresponds to n odd for us. So let pi be a permutation in Sn and R be some number between 1 and n plus 1. And Ln is the set of positions, which if you want to look at this example, is all the positions occupied by the permutation plus one extra position in each one. So what we'll do is we'll place the chips pi 1 through pi n in these consecutive positions. And we'll increase the labels in pi which are greater than or equal to r by 1. And we'll add r to the other. And we'll call this initial condition pi r. So let's look at this example. So pi is 2, 5, 1, 3. Sigma is 2, 5, 1, 3, 4. And I'm adding chip r. I'm taking r equals 2. So any one remains one at the origin, and all the others are labels are shifted by one. So I get 3, 6, 1, 4, 5, and I add 2. Is that clear? So these are going to be our initial conditions. And what we will do now is to run this process, this label chip firing process on these guys. And so what you can think, this is what I mean by the dynamical system. So now we have this toppling dynamics, and you can think of this toppling dynamics as inducing a map from this pairs where pi is a permutation and r is an element from 1 through n plus 1 to a new permutation Sn plus 1, in Sn plus 1. Okay? And because at the end you will get a permutation at the end if you ignore the pole in this. And similarly, when n is odd, you know, you can't do it symmetrically, so there's a slight case. So there's one less chip on the left as compared to the right, but it makes no difference. One can do it the other way. The results. So at the end, you'll get a permutation. You'll get chips where there is at most one per each side, and you can read it off as a permutation. That permutation will live in Sn plus 1. And So we say that a permutation pi is R top level if this dynamical system results in an identity permutation, results in the sorted permutation. And we say that pi is top level if pi is R top level for all R. Okay, so there are a couple of caveats. First of all, you might be worried that this dynamical system is not well defined. Remember that the process is stochastic, I mean, it's a probabilistic process. So what do I mean by saying that this is a dynamical, I mean, this could be a stochastic dynamical system. I mean, I need not get a well-defined map in principle, but I'll show you that that's not a problem. The second issue you might worry about is, what if there is no such pi? I mean, there could be the set of R top level permutations as I arrange over all R need not have could have empty intersection. So I'll show you that that's also not okay. Okay, so this proposition lays to rest the first worry. So pi is in Sn, R belongs to 1 through n plus 1, and so what we show is that this stopping dynamical system on Ln satisfies the following, starting with pi R, satisfies the following properties. First of all, the final configuration is deterministic. So there is, even though the original process was random, here there is no stochasticity, everything is completely different. I mean, the order of the moves may not be, but the final configuration is certainly. Moreover, at every time step, the configuration lives in Ln, and this is the reason we added extra empty positions at the ends. And in the final configuration, there's precisely one chip at every position, except the origin when n is odd and position one when n is odd. Okay, and the key idea of these proofs is that no position can contain more than two chips at any time. So if this is the case, then whenever you choose that site, you don't have a choice. The smaller one there goes left and the larger one goes right. So that's the key idea in proving this. Construct pi hat by subtracting every element from pi n plus 1 and reading it from right to left, reading it in Urdu. So what we say is that the toppling dynamics on pi r is isomorphic to that on pi hat with n plus 2 minus r being the expression. And the map is just reflecting configurations about the origin and interchanging I and n plus 2. And since identity hat is also identity, pi is R top level if and only if pi hat is n plus 2 minus R. So what this says when n is odd is that the number of R top level permutations is equal to the number of n plus 2 minus R. So these are permutations which are R top level for all R. So for n equals 3, I mean, you can check by hand that there are 4 1 top level permutations. That is to say, if I add 1 in the center and shift all these labels by 1, I will end up with the top level permutation. I will end up with the sorted permutation 1, 2, 3, 4. And by the symmetry I explained earlier, there are also 4 top level permutations. And if you see, if you compare these two sets, you'll see that the first 3 are common, and the fourth one is. So T1 of 3 and T4 of 3 are 4. With common permutations, these three ones turn out also to be 2 and 3 tuple. And these are the only ones. So T of 3 is equal to these. T2 of 3 which is T3 of 3. Okay. So here is some data for n equals 3 to 8 for different values of R. Remember, R goes from 1 to n plus 1. And you can see the symmetry for n odd. So if you look, this 9 and 20. For n even, there's no symmetry, but you might see that the middle two numbers are the same. Middle interpreted. Okay. So our main goal is to enumerate T of n and TR of n. Okay, so now to explain the main result, I recall some notation for permutations, which you might have seen. So an exceedance in any permutation pi is a position I such that pi I is greater than I. So that it exceeds, the value exceeds the position. That's the etymology. So the positions at which there are exceedances the set of positions is called the exceedance. And in this nice paper from 2000, Richard Ehrenberg and Inner Steingrimson, they studied permutations whose exceedance set is 1 through k. So that is to say there are exceedances in the first k positions and no exceedances in the thing. But remember, there's a strict equality. So pi I equal to I does not count. So, and they gave a nice formula for the number of not very simple, but a summation formula for the number of such permutations, A and K. Okay. So K can vary from 0 to n minus 1. K is 0 means there is no exceedance. And if you think a little, you can convince yourself that the identity permutation is the only one which has no exceedance. And if you look also at K equals n minus 1, that is, there is an exceedance at every position except the last. Notice that the last cannot be an exceedance because pi n cannot be greater than n. So k can only range from 0 to n minus 1. And it turns out that the number of permutations with exceedance, the exceedance set 1 through n minus 1 is also 1. And again, you can explicitly write down what that is. But what's one really surprising result, which is not at all obvious, is that A and K is the same as A and N minus 1 minus K. So there is a symmetry here. And it's not at all obvious, and I think there is no bijective point. But of course, they proved it. So later on, Ehrenberg with his student found the generating function of these guys. And here you can see the symmetry, the double exponential generating function, a really nice expression. And here you can see the symmetry. So our main result is a formula for the number of top-level permutations, T of n. And it's exactly this A and K, where n is n and k is n minus 1. So it's the central one. Okay. And fortunately for us, this group of people had already obtained asymptotics for these A and k's in this paper, 2015. And we directly borrow it without doing any work, and we get that Tn is roughly n factorial by 2 log 2 to the n. That's some constant. Okay? And some correction. Okay, so let me mention some connections to graph theory as well, graph enumeration. So suppose G is a simple undirected graph. So an orientation of G is an assignment of arrows, any assignment whatsoever. Okay, just give arrows to the edges. And an acyclic orientation is an orientation where there is no directed cycle. So you cannot go along the edges in the direction of the arrows and form a cycle. That's, if that happens, you get an acyclic. And this you probably all know, a proper coloring of G is an assignment of colors to the vertices such that no two adjacent vertices get the same color. And the chromatic polynomial of G, denoted chi G of Q, is the number of proper colorings of G with two colors. So there's a beautiful theorem due to Richard Stanley from 1973. It says that the number of acyclic orientations of G up to sign is the chromatic polynomial evaluated at minus 1. So, of course, when you define the chromatic polynomial originally, you want Q to be an integer, positive integer. But it turns out that Q equals minus 1 has a combinatorial meaning, and it's exactly the number of acyclic. So, for example, here is the 4 cycle C4. And I have drawn 7 of the 14 acyclic orientations. The other 7 are obtained by flipping the direction of the arrows. So in me, SO stands for source and SI stands for sink. So, so if you notice, there are 7 of which 5 of them have one source and one sink, and 2 of them have, 6 of them have two source, one source and a sink, and one of them has two sources and a sink. And actual numbers. And the chromatic polynomial is given by this. I mean, I'll explain the colors in a second. Okay, so there's a refined notion, refinement of this notion, which is called acyclic orientation with unique sink. So, the name suggests what the definition is. So, an acyclic orientation with a unique sink is an acyclic orientation which has exactly one sink and therefore also one source. Oh, sorry, no, I take that back. It has exactly one sink. And this generalization of Stanley's theorem is this theorem of Green and Zaslavsky from 1983, which says that the number of AUSOs of G, again up to sign, turns out to be independent of the sink, which is highly non-trivial, and equal, again up to sign, to the linear coefficient of chi G of minus. So you take the chromatic polynomial, So take the chromatic polynomial and look at the linear coefficient. So in this example, the linear coefficient up to sign is 3, and that corresponds to the fact that there are 3 acyclic orientations I meant to take this as a sink. There are exactly 3 acyclic orientations where the sink is over here. You can see. So these are the 3 AUSOs. So a second main result is as follows. So you recall that KMN is the complete bipartite graph, and for example, C4 is isomorphic to K2. And for all n, Tn, the number of top level permutations, is equal to the number of AUSOs of this bipartite graph, where one part is ceiling of n by 2 and the other is floor of n by 2. And this part of the proof is bijective, using mean result. So to tell you about the last theorem, last theorem about TR of n, I need to define what a polybernoulli number is. So this notion, so to define this, I recall the poly logarithm, which you might have seen from number theory. it's you know, just like you have the logarithm is log of 1 plus or 1 minus z is minus of that is z to the i. You change the I to the k, change the I to the k, and you get what's called the polynomial. So it depends on two parameters, k and the functions. So to state what I need, I recall some notion. So in a permutation, a position is an ascent if pi k is less than pi k plus 1. Okay, so it's ascending. And the Eulerian number, this angle m to j is the number of, this should be n. Is the L n angle j is the number of permutations in Sn with j. So this is a very well studied sequence. Again, as in many things, named for Euler, named after Euler. So what one can do is, you know, here instead of taking k, you can take a negative integer. So I take Li of minus m, where m is a non-negative integer. Then this guy goes upstairs, and then this is well known that you get this nice generated function involving the Eulerian numbers. And these polybinomial numbers were defined by Kaneko, the Japanese number theorist, by the exponential generating function, which looks kind of strange. So it's a single variable exponential generating function. It involves k, so b and k, x to the n minus factorial. It has this polylogarithm with this funny exponent, 1 minus e to the minus x. So this is how he defined it, and then he proved that somewhat surprisingly, this satisfies funny symmetry. Bkn is the same as b and k. So this was defined some time ago. And afterwards, people realized that there are many combinatorial interpretations for this. So, for this sequence, these are all integers, which he already realized. For example, the number of acyclic orientations of the complete bipartite integer of k and k is b and k. And let me give you another one. So, a permutation pi in S of k plus n is said to be a k n Westergombe permutation. Westergombe is the number of permutation. If pi I minus I is bounded between minus k and n. So, that is, if you take the value and the position and you take the difference, it's at most minus k, at least minus k and at most n for all k. For all I. Okay, so if you look at it as a matrix, you know, it stays around the diagonal roughly, depending on what you mean. That describes the width about the diagonal. So the number of Kn Westergombe permutations is also b. There are many other interpretations, just to give you an idea. So here are the first polybinomial numbers, b and k, and you can see they're symmetric. Okay, and so, for example, when n equals 1, you always get powers of 2, this is 0 to 2, then they get more. Okay, to state our last main result, I need some notation. So a forward difference operator, delta, is one where when it acts on a sequence f of n, it will give you f of n plus 1 minus f of n. So it's forward because you take f of n plus 1. And there's a similar backward difference operator, which is f of n minus f of n minus 1. And you can obtain the higher difference operators by composition. So for example, delta squared of f n is f n plus 2 minus 2. And so you can see what the general pattern is. And there are some binomial coefficients involved, and this is related to the binomial transform. And the zeroth difference operator, we just take the sequences. So this is our last main result, and this explains all these numbers. So we now have a combinatorial interpretation of all these numbers. And it says that TR of n is the R minus 1th forward difference of these, this particular polynomial number vector, where T is the floor of n plus 1 by 2. And delta should act on the, or acts only on the first index. So it treats the second index. So you only act on this index and not this. So this is our result in the paper earlier this year. And but we do much more, you know, we also generalize this to any position of adding the extra chip. So in this, in what I'm about to explain, the extra chip is always in the center, but we generalize that. And also we characterize final, all possible final permutations, not, I mean, here we are only looking at the identity in this talk, but what we do is we see what are the possible permutations, and there's a nice characterization. And we also enumerate permutations coupling to these final. Okay, so I will not say anything more about this main result 3. I will try to give some flavor of the ideas for main results 1 and 2. And I don't think I'll have any time to go into extensions. Okay, so for each of these, for main results 1 and 2, the results for odd and even n differ slightly. And, you know, there'll be a, if I, you know, I'm extremely pedantic, I'll have floors and ceilings all over the place, and that will make it very hard to understand. So I will only state the result for odd n, which is the symmetric case, and which corresponds to the even sorting in HMP. Okay. If you want to see the whole result, the complete results, you can see the output. Okay, so what is, so the sequence of ideas I want to explain, I mean, they're not individually very complicated. Okay, so the first idea is the following. So suppose a permutation is R toppler, okay, in 2n plus 1. We are always talking in R. So then what one can show without too much difficulty is that the, any chip on the left, so it's R topplable, means at the end you get the identity. Okay, so that means, so what we can show is that the last move of chip K, which is on the left, is to the left. Okay, when chip K settles down, it has to topple to the left. It cannot have toppled. And conversely for the other side, and similarly for the other side. And in the last move, chips M plus 1 and M to topple from the center to the left. Okay, that's, so these three are, one can show these two from induction and the last from very simple. So this lemma is key in proving the following result, which is that suppose pi is R minus 1 topplable, where R is less than or equal to n plus 1. So we are in 2 n plus 1. If pi is R topplable, then it is R minus 1. And similarly, when R is more than half, then pi is R plus 1 topplable if pi is R. So this is what we call monotonicity. And similarly, the last result is pi is M plus 1 topplable if and only if it is M plus 2 topplable. So if you go back to the data, you will notice that from the center outwards, the numbers are increasing. So for the symmetric case, I mean, for an odd, I only need to look about the middle, on one side. So 31, 38, 46, for example. So this says that every permutation which corresponds, which contributes here, or also contributes here, and also contributes here. But even when n is... even this is true. So these numbers are also monotonically increasing apart from the center, and these two are equal.
So that means reverse alternate, reverse Sini model is data. Reverse Sini model meaning it decreases with it.
And then exactly. That's what this is.
What is this?
So some of you might have already noticed it. So this, so what this says is that its permutation is toppleable if it is toppleable at the center. That's all we need. Maybe I'm running out of time, so I mean the proof is a bit involved. Okay, maybe I can go through some part of it. One side is so suppose pi is R toppled. Okay. So I'm going to assume R is less than or equal to n plus 1. Okay, so the chip in the center that you're writing has will eventually end up on the left. Okay, so suppose pi is R toppled. Now I'm going to compare what happens to pi. I'm going to compare pi r and pi r minus 1. Right? But if you think about how we constructed pi r and pi r minus 1, we shifted all the labels of pi greater than or equal to r by 1 and added r at the same. Similarly here. So the only difference is that the positions of r minus 1 and r are integers. There's no other difference. So by definition, r is at the origin in pi r. And suppose j is the position of r minus 1 in pi r. Okay? So if j is 0, then pi r is equal to pi r minus 1. And then, of course, whatever moves you do in pi r, you do in pi r minus 1. And, you know, so if pi r is r toppleable, then it's 0. But if not, now in each step, pi r and pi r minus 1 will continue to differ only in the positions of r minus 1 and r. Right? The inequalities, I mean, anything else that is greater than r will also be greater than r minus 1, and smaller than r will also be smaller than r. So, this will continue to be the case until we reach a point where r minus 1 and r are at the same position. So, then we have kind of merged, we have coupled these two dynamical systems, and the final result is then identical. What is the problem with this argument? The problem is that one could have reached the final result without ever being coupled. Okay? And that the part is a bit more complicated and so for like that. But this is the complicated part of the proof. We need a double induction and we use the lemma that I mentioned. Okay, so that's the first idea. So monotonicity. So that means now it's enough to look at r equal to whatever m or n plus 1. Okay. All right. Now we have remember that I said that the final configuration is deterministic. So if it's deterministic, the order I can choose which order to topple it. I can pick my favorite sequence of topples. Okay. And this is the notion of a pass. So let me explain what a pass is. So let's just focus on the number of chips. Okay. So initially, there are one chip set to the left of the origin, two at the origin, and one to the right of the origin, and empty at the end. So I'll use hat to denote the origin. Okay. Now what happens at the first stage? This topples, giving one to the left, one to the right, and become empty. Right? So now there are two here. Now at the next stage, what happens? You can choose an order, but it doesn't really matter. So this two will topple, giving one to the left, one to the origin. This will topple, giving one to the left, one to the origin, and one to the right. And you'll end up with this, where two are at the origin. Again. Okay? Now, I don't topple this. So I fix this. Okay? I don't touch this anymore. And I topple this too. So this will give one to the left, one to the right, and it will become empty. Similarly, this. And I now topple those two, and so on. So I leave the origin untouched, and I topple all the others. Then I arrive at this configuration where there is one chip at the endmost point empty to its right, and similarly on the other side. And now the remaining looks exactly like the original, with size one less or two less. Okay. So these extremal points now, I claim, cannot be modified any further. For them to be modified, you will need to have two chips here, but that can never happen. At the next pass, you do the same exact thing. You start from the origin, couple, etc., etc. You will reach this configuration. At the end of the second pass, these two will be frozen. You'll have empty, and those two will be frozen. And then you have a smaller. And now you continue this way. So if n is odd, after n plus 1 by 2 passes, you'll get a frozen, completely frozen configuration. At the last stage, you'll only have dash 2 dash, and then couple n. So couple of observations. So every chip between any two vacancies will topple at least once in every pass. Okay, it could topple multiple times, but it will topple at least. And if pi is toppleable, then at the ith pass, both I and 2n plus 2 minus I will get fixed at the end of the ith pass. Okay, so let's look at an example. So let's look. I'll explain the first pass and I'll leave the others for you to check. So let's look at this. So in the first, let's go through the first pass. So the first stage, 1 will go left, 2 will go right. And now let's look on the left. So I have 1, 6, empty. So 1 will go left, 6 will go right. Then 1 will go, and then I have 1, 3. 1 will go left, 3 will go right. So I have 1 dash 3, 6. Now look at the right side. I'll have 2, 4 here and empty. 2 will go left, 4 will go right. Then I have 4, 5, 4 will go left, 2 will go right. So I have 2, 4, dash 5. So that's this. Okay? And now you can do this, and so you get the second pass, you reach here, and then third pass, there's only one toppling. So already by the first pass, you know that this is not toppleable. Because 6 has not come here. Right? So there's no way in hell, because now this is frozen, and there's no way 6 can come and occupy. Okay, so this notion of passes allows us to decompose what's going on. So here is the lemma. So if pi is toppleable, then 1 cannot be to a position larger than n plus 1. So 1 is in position at most n plus 1. And conversely, if 1 is in position at most n plus 1, then 1 does reach its correct position at the end. Both sides are easy to see. So suppose 1 is to the right of the origin, then in the first pass, 1 will move exactly one position to the left. 1 is the smallest, so it has to move one position to the left. But that pass then moves rightwards, so it does not touch 1 anymore. Okay? But therefore it will get frozen on. It will move exactly once and it will get frozen. But whatever, but the thing which is, has to be, it has to have been in the correct position, which is the extreme left, at the end of the first pass, which is not possible. So pi cannot be toppleable if it's to that. Now suppose it is in a position on or to the left of the center, then at some point, during the first pass, it will get a partner. Because as I said, every guy has to move at least one. So once it gets a partner, it moves left because it's the smallest. Then it again has a partner and it will move left. So it will continue to move left until it reaches its left. Okay? And a similar argument works. Okay, so this, generalizing this, will prove our structure theorem, which says the following, that a permutation is n plus 1 toppleable if and only if pi I is at most n plus 1, is at most n plus I for I between 1 to n, or forget that. Let me talk in terms of positions. So this says that the position of the ith chip, where I is less than or equal to m plus 1, is in the first m plus i position. Sorry, let me say that again. The ith chip is in the first m plus i positions for I between 1 through m plus 1. And for the others, I is in a position which is greater than or equal to I minus. Okay, so the first I positions can only be so much so far in the left. And the last I positions can only be so far as the left. And this uses the notion of the pass and this previous lemma I'm using some of that. And the last lemma is that such permutations are in bijection with permutations whose exceedance set is 1. And this is a simple bijection where you flip the order of the first m positions separately and the last m position, last m plus two positions separately and or m plus one position separately, and you subtract it. And one can see this with a quick example where you consider permutations in S5 starting with 3, and these are the top level permutations, and if you let me just show you what to do. So you flip these two and flip these three, so you will get 1 3 5 4 2, and you subtract everything from 6, you will get 5. And one can check that this has exceedance. Okay, so these 5 is greater than 1, 3 is greater than 2, but these 3 are not exceedance. So similarly. Okay, so I mean it's not hard. So to summarize, so then we have proven main result 1, which is the following chain of ideas. By the monotonicity result, as explained, it's enough to compute the number of m plus 1 top level permutations. And according to our structure theorem, those m plus 1 top level permutations satisfy this condition. And this previous lemma bijectively shows that the number of permutations is ma2 m plus 1. So this proves main result. How much time do I have, Rajesh?
Yeah, I mean, you can take 5 more minutes.
Sorry?
5 more minutes. Again.
Okay, 5 more minutes. Okay. So so we have some extensions which I can explain. Maybe I'll just state the results. So is that, remember what the problem was? You have n chips at the origin and you are doing this topic, this random topic. What they show is that no matter what order you topple things, the chip labeled K does not stray too far from the center. It can be between these positions. Okay? So it lies somewhere from somewhere to the left to somewhere to the right. It cannot go arbitrarily. Okay, so this means that the final configuration will also satisfy this. So this is at all times. Okay, so now we can ask ourselves, what permutations satisfy these conditions? Okay, and for n even, the only permutation is identity. So this is really non-trivial. I mean, this condition is too weak. But we consider this case also, and this is not directly relevant. So translating, I mean, because this was at the origin and so on, we have to shift indices and so on. We say that a permutation is collapsed if the position of the kth chip is at most ceiling of k by 2 if n is odd, or 1 plus floor of k by 2 if n is even. and this is at least that, and is at most ceiling of n by 2 plus floor of n. Okay, I mean the floors and ceilings occur only because of Hashian. And so let Gn be the set of all collapsed permutations. Okay, so to state our result, let me recall the Zeidel triangle. So this is a famous number triangle. So rather than reading this definition, let me just show you the first few rows. So this is how the triangle looks like. So so it has this kind of double staircase shape. So what you do is in every even row, you sum over all the entries in the row above, you starting above and going to the right. So for example, this 6 is 3 plus 3, this 8 is 2 plus 3. So like that. Okay? This 34 is 70%. But in the odd rows, you do the other way around. So you sum the entries of the row above, starting above you and going to the left. So this 3 is 2 plus 1. This 14 is 8 plus 6. 17 is 8 plus 6. Okay, so you can, this is called the Zeidel triangle. It's quite old, more than 100 years. There's a repetition of the leftmost diagonal and the rightmost diagonal. So these numbers on the diagonals are called the Genoa-Key numbers. They're also a sequence. And okay, since I don't have much time, I won't say what these numbers are. There's just like you have Stirling numbers of the first and second kind, you have Genoa-Key numbers of the first and second kind. These are the first kind, these are the second kind, they have some combinatorial meanings. And our results are the number of collapsed permutations for odd of odd size are the Genoa-Key numbers of the first kind. And the blue numbers, which are, as I said, the Genoa-Key numbers of the second kind, are related to the number of collapsed permutations of even size. Okay, so again, we get some nice combinatorics, and the proof follows by this interesting sequence of this interesting configurations known as the Lac configurations, which have been studied a long time ago. Rather nice objects. Okay, so since I've run out of time, let me stop and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Arvind. Yeah, audience, if you have any question, you can ask me.
Arvind, can I ask?
Yes.
So for any results for this type B, that is if you have permutations which are signed, then how many are sort level, how many are top level? That is you sort and you get the identity.
Good question. No, we did not think of that.
Said this sorting procedure is terribly inefficient. I mean, how terrible is this terrible? That is like n cube operations or worse?
Yeah, n cube, exactly. N-cube. Yeah. Because you have to do n choose, I mean, you have to choose two at a time. And so it's,
correct. Some recurrence. Yeah. Okay.
So I think the state of the art is what? N log n or something?
Yeah, n log n is the. You can't do better than that for comparison based sorting.
Right. Yeah, so this is hard.
Yeah.
But it's really beautiful. Yeah. The fact that you can always get sorted for even n. I mean, that you can always arrange, right? So if you have a list, you just add plus infinity.
Yeah.
With the odd elements.
Correct. Yeah, a lot of material. I need it again. I have to compile the whole thing. It's still not fully gone.
A lot
of material.
Yeah. It's way too much. But
see that, one more final question. See that Stanley's theorem, no? There is a connection between symmetry functions and that number of acyclic orientations. In the introduction you had, no? There's chromatic polynomial evaluated at minus 1. That will give you the number of acyclic orientations.
Right.
So that has a symmetric function generalization.
Chromatic symmetric function.
Yeah, and also the other result of Zaslavsky, does it also have another one where the number of sinks that is there?
So that's of a different nature, right? Because that's the coefficient.
So maybe in that symmetry function you take inner product with something else and then you get. Is there a symmetry function generalization of that other result of Zaslavsky that I'm asking? Because this is well known, Stanley's.
Yeah, this one.
Evaluation at -1 and symmetry function generalization. But the other one, that is, it's a refinement. I won't say refinement. It gives you a linear coefficient. So there is there a symmetry function counterpart?
Very good question. Yeah, I don't know.
Just ask it.
Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah, maybe we're thinking about that.
Okay. Are there other questions? Yeah, Arvind.
Yeah, sorry, there was not enough class theory for you.
Okay, it's okay. Yeah, it's really interesting. We enjoyed. Yeah. See, Arvind, in this Zaslavsky's result, by linear coefficient, you mean a coefficient of the x, right? That linear term.
Of Q.
Okay. So the coefficient of the higher powers, if you see, say Q squared, Q cube, will they have any combinatorial description like in terms of sinks?
I think, I don't remember. Krishnan, do you know?
Even I don't know. In the number of things with K sinks, that may be known.
That's not this.
That won't be this. Yeah, of course. Because this third is a plus minus sum, no? The coefficient is correct. The chromatic polynomial always alternate in sign. So you can't just get one something for this and just say it with K6. That's not true. That won't be true.
Yeah, right.
Trivial thing. But
I vaguely remember that there is something, but it's kind of intractable.
I also don't.
But I don't remember.
Are there other questions? Okay. If not, thank you, Arvind, for the interesting talk. Yeah. Thank you, Krishna. Yeah.
Yeah. Very good talk. Yeah.
So, Arvind, could you send the slides? I can circulate with the participants.
Okay. Maybe I'll fix some typos.
Sure. And I have recorded the talk. I will upload in YouTube.
Sure.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay. All right.
Take care, everybody. Thank you. Thanks, Ramesh.
Thanks.
Hi.